I don't care what labels you've been given by people. This is not you. But you can't quite fit it back on the journey because the road is narrow. Doesn't allow the broad arms to spread out. So we go, okay, no worries, Jesus. What I'll do is that's fine. I can't fit it through, but that's okay. What I'll do is, oh yeah, that's great. Fantastic. Hang on a minute. We'll drag it down the narrow road. That'd be great. That'd be cool. Still got it. That's fine. All right. Okay. It's fitted. It's with me. But it doesn't sit on you fully because it's not you anymore. You've been released from it. But somehow we let it attach itself to us. And we are the ones who've put it on because we've been given the power in Jesus to be broken from it. You already died to it on the cross. So you leave it attached, and then you walk down the narrow road, and after a while you think, hang on, I just want to enjoy this for a while, I'll come back to you later. And you turn, and then you fiddle in your bag, and you might pull out something, oh yeah, that's fun, I'll have some of that, play with that for a while. Yeah, Jesus, I'll be there in a minute, yeah, okay, I'm just dealing with my old life for a while, I'm just enjoying this for a minute. Oh yeah, repent, yeah, you're right. But you don't let it go. You still have it attached because you want to carry on enjoying some of it. You think that life of joy and abundance is not the true promise that Jesus brings. You think you still need to look back at what's attached to you. So you walk this narrow road with this dragging on you, slowing you down, when Jesus is saying, be released. Be released. Live life.
Associate Pastor Warren McNeil takes us on a walk through the verses of Matthew that hit home for Christians for all the wrong reasons. The narrow road is not restrictive, but freedom in who we are meant to be. Yet we insist on dragging our old self through the narrow door and along the narrow road. Come, invite God to break the chains that are attached to your old baggage and run free towards the single vision that is Jesus.
Father, I pray for your spirit as we go forward for the rest of today and into the week, Lord, that your spirit will bring only the shalom that you can bring. Maybe bring healing and wholeness. It may be situations in our past that we've not dealt with. Through your Son Jesus we pray. Amen. So John 10:10, I have come so they may have life and have it to the full. When Jesus was speaking, he was speaking in the context in John of being a good shepherd, shepherd of his sheep, and his sheep will know his voice. You may turn to it if you wish, but we're not going to stay there for very long. He was contrasting in all of that the idea of a fake shepherd, and the fake shepherd is a thief in reality. Anybody who's ever owned a farm knows that rustlers come and steal their sheep. Anybody here ever owned a farm? I've not. So you don't like them because they don't hear the shepherd's voice. The thief only wishes to steal, to kill and destroy the life of the sheep. Jesus was talking in the context that his sheep know his voice. If you know Jesus, you are his sheep and he is your shepherd. Now, faith entices sheep, apparently. Do you know what sheep eat? They eat grass, clover, and other pasture plants, according to Wikipedia. Not exactly what I would consider the most exciting of diets, but apparently sheep really like it. Unfortunately, sheep also like cake and candy. They like their sugar, apparently. So where the shepherd knows what's good for the sheep would only give them the grass and the pasture. A thief might try and entice them over with sugar. And the sheep duly would come and eat it, not understanding it's not good for the sheep. And at that point, the sheep is in the clutches of the thief. As it says in the Bible, everything is permissible, but not necessarily everything is beneficial. And that could sound like us. We can be easily enticed by the sweet things of life, the things that look like they're okay. And we're going to continue to look at that in a moment. Jesus also makes it very clear in the John 10 passage that he is the gate for the sheep. It's an interesting John in that whole passage, and we should know it really well. It's a very much an unpacking of the fact that he uses lots of different pictures, views of Jesus. So you've got initially Jesus being the shepherd, but you've also got him being the gate. Jesus says, I am the gate. It's always one of those interesting things when people say, take the Bible literally. Good, so Jesus squeaks then on hinges, yes? But Jesus is the gate. And he says, whoever enter by this through the sheep, they will enter into life. They will be saved, they will come in, and they will find fresh pasture if you enter via Jesus. And Jesus also made it very clear in John 14, 6, that he is the way, the truth, and the life. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. So all of that in John sounds really exciting. Come in, come and enter, come and have life to the full, come and have abundance. And it is exciting. But Jesus also stated this. Could you turn with me to Matthew chapter 7? Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 to 14, which if you have a Mauve Bible, it's at page 971. Have you got it? It's incredibly well-known verses. Enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to destruction. And many enter through it. But small is the gate and narrow the road that leads to life. And only a few find it. I'll read it again. Enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to destruction. And many enter through it. But small is the gate and narrow the road that leads to life, and only a few find it. Now, partly this is the teaching that we're going to be unpacking, but not probably in the normal way that we normally do, where there's lots of questions and answers and there's, I try and unpack the behind the scenes stuff, because I think for this morning, God wants to say something to everyone. But I believe for some of us, we're really going to have something open up inside of us. God's going to crack something inside of us. He's going to release us this morning. Do you want to be released? No, do you really want to be released? Okay, being released is not comfortable. Be warned and be very, very, very aware. Being released is not comfortable. Sometimes you suddenly realize that you are free. And then you suddenly realize, I have choice. And then you suddenly realize, what choices do I make? So if you're prepared this morning for God to release you, be prepared to listen to him in what goes on now in the next 20 minutes. His spirit is here. He's already been working in us this morning. Already been doing some shaking and shifting. I mean, Jesus never promised the easy life, but he promised a life full of abundance and joy, the joy that's a deep joy. So be prepared to be shifted and released this morning. Now, when we read these verses, I know over many, many, many years, and I include myself in this camp, that these feel very condemnatory verses. If you feel your relationship with God, note this phrase, feel your relationship with God is not the best in the world. You sometimes read these and you'll go, I'm the one on the wide road. I'm the one going to destruction. People read these and skip over them. Don't like that one. If that's you this morning, don't need to nod or raise your hand, but acknowledge it for yourself. If you read these verses and think, that's me, we'll look at it as we go. I'm hoping in this that we're going to dispel some of the shadowy oppression that reading those two verses bring. And if you're saying, no, Pastor, we're not like that at all. I find these really releasing. Fantastic. But there's a lot of Christians who seem to read that because I think teaching over the years, not in this church, but just general teaching seems to have this real sense of restriction about it. And I want us to unpack that, okay? So as we go through this, please bear in mind John 10:10. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. Okay? Are you with me on this? I just want to make sure everybody's with me. Everybody with me? Yes. Excellent. So enter the narrow gate. The gate is narrow, it feels like. It's restrictive, it feels like. It feels like there is only one gate, by the way. And it's Jesus, as we said. There is only one way to heaven. Do you know why they use the term gate in the Bible? We use it all the time. Gate, doorway. Behold, I stand and knock. And we all use these things for doors. Do you know why? Well, actually, back in those days, the term was used because the common belief was there were many gates or many doors and secret gates to get into the heavenly realms. That was the understanding in Jesus' time. There was many different ways, and it was all done by knowledge. If you knew secret knowledge, you could find the secret gateway that would get you into the heavenly realms. Okay? I'm thinking back to the movies like Percy Jackson. Anybody watch those? No? Okay. I have a daughter who's still young enough. That's my thing. But there, they have ways of finding, apparently, secret doors. If you find certain pearls and gems or something, that will help reveal a certain door into a certain, either into Olympus or into Hades, but we won't go there. But the idea of this concept of different doorways into heavenly realms is very much in this thinking. This is why Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, the life. I am the gate. I am the good shepherd. You only come via me. There's one door. And it's narrow. This concept that they had back then was there was lots of different ways that lead to God. All roads lead to God. Oh, that sounds like us today, does it not? Our society today. All roads, all different religions, they all lead to the same God. But we've got to be honest. That's not true. So, narrow gate, narrow road, broad gate, broad road. Let's try and look at it. Why is the gate that Jesus says is the best road to go on? We all know this. He says he's the narrow door, the narrow gate, and that actually that's the best one to enter through, yes? Seems very restrictive, doesn't it? Has this sense of restriction? Does everybody have that? The narrow road, a sense of restriction? Sense of being trapped, not quite going to fit? Well, there's a reason for that, and we're going to look at that. So hence why Jesus, when he's teaching on the hill here, he's talking about gates. He's trying to explain that actually the one that is narrow, the one that leads to real life, hasn't got choice. There is something about it. So we're going to see if we can try and describe some of this, and this is going to be interesting. So, you may or may not notice this morning that there's two chairs on the stage, and they're quite far apart. And there's two chairs here, but they're a lot closer together. It's the first time ever front row chairs you don't have to sit on. But this feels like, to me, the wide gate. I'm small enough to fit through it, comfortably. I can take two or three with me side by side as we enter. This is the wide gate. This is what society says is the wide area. This is what our society says today. Choose. You've got all of this. Isn't it wonderful? You have choice. You can walk along. You can do as you please. Pick up things as you go along. Pick and choose as you go. I mean, seriously, look. Oh, wow. I can have this. Fantastic. Oh, I'll have that. There's nothing wrong with that, is there? No, that's fine. That's nice and shiny. There's nothing wrong with that at all. That's fine. Oh, thank you. Oh, over here as well. Wow. I can have this and all. Look at that. That's shiny. I can have that as well. Oh, no, go over here. Seriously. Oh, really? Thank you. Wow. Oh, this is fun in here. Look at all the electronics. Wow. Then he was worried I was putting out an amp, huh? But this is what our society says. Come on in. Enjoy. It's okay. You can choose whatever you want. It's not going to harm you. It's like the grass and the sugar. And then, oh, wow, look at what I can have here. Oh, this is fantastic. Yeah, I'll put that on my back. Ugh. Oh, fantastic. Great. Oh, that's getting a bit heavy now. But I'm okay. I've got all these things. This is fantastic. This is good. Wow, I am definitely enjoying the broad road. This is fine. I can do whatever I want. Wow. Fantastic. Thanks. And this is what society says you can have. If you see the names on any of these bags or anything, I'm not saying that these companies are bad, okay? Just use that disclaimer now. But this is what the wide gate, and this actually also defines for me something about sometimes we who follow Jesus in discipleship. We like to pick up along the things that society says we can have, the things that are permissible, but not necessarily beneficial. Bearing in mind, John 10:10, I have come to give life, life in all its fullness and abundance. And actually, when we pick up these things and put these things on our backs, and if you want to know what's in this rucksack, it's my college work. It could be my identity of my degree level or some qualification I've got or whatever it wants to be. This sort of becomes my identity on my back. Maybe my job. Or maybe some leisure time I have. And this is my leisure time in here. But I don't know you, but I can't actually do anything else with it now. I'm feeling somewhat restricted. But this is what I've got. And then Jesus says, but you know, that's wide and that's broad and that actually leads to destruction. But when you come to know Jesus, when you come to enter through the narrow gate, there is something else. Now, this is the narrow gate. Jesus is here at the narrow gate. When you come to Jesus at the narrow gate, he might ask you to drop some of the false identity that you have and you're laden down with. I actually guarantee you he will do. When you've been baptized, you're dying to your old self, aren't you? And you're becoming a new creation. Why is it narrow? Well, I'll be honest with you, you can't take this all through with you because it ain't going to fit. So I need to lose some of my soul. So I need to allow Jesus to take it off. I don't do it. Jesus does it for me in baptism. Jesus does it for me when I accept him as my Lord and Saviour. He comes and removes everything off my back, puts it down, and says, you're a new creation. Come on in. So I walk in, unfettered, free, able to walk the narrow road, which feels really restrictive. When we read those verses, we think narrow road. I'm restricted. I can't be who I want to be. No, you are who God created you to be in the first place. You don't take up the lies and the sugar and candy that is on the stage. So when you're a Christian, you're walking down this narrow path. Do you know why it's narrow? Because there's one vision at the end of the road. When you started, and for those that are new Christians that got baptized already this year, you've walked through here, and man, you've got a fantastic road and a beautiful vision right at the end, and it's God. And it's his vision for you, his life, in his church and in his kingdom here on earth and then the future at the end. Unlike the broad road, which says, come over here, check this out. You might get distracted. On the narrow road, you can't be distracted. It has one vision. It's a great narrow road. It's full of life and abundance, but sometimes in us it doesn't feel like it. And it's discipleship. It's about walking with God, having that one vision, not needing to be distracted. Problem is with most of us sometimes is what happens. We start the journey really well. And note this, I include myself in this. We start the journey fantastically. Yeah, full of it. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise, I'm filled with the Spirit. Wow, this is fantastic. Been baptized. Give it some. Jesus, all for you and nothing else. Yeah? Am I getting no nods, getting no shakes? Nobody agree with that? Okay. Well, I started like that. Lasted 6 months and it was absolutely fantastic. Lost a load of friends in the process, but hey, don't worry about it. But I all for Jesus. But what happens is, so my identity now is in Christ. That's the point. This single vision is God, who you created me to be. I don't have to worry about this lot. I'm single focus for you. My identity is now different. So we walk that road, praising the Lord, and then trouble clearly comes our way because we weren't promised the easy life. The churches in the UK and around the world would be filled to the brim if coming to Jesus meant that you was going to get the easy life. Yeah? Everybody would go, well, I'll have that, that's easy. You mean no trouble coming my way? No hassle, no problems? That's the thief trying to get your distraction. Not blaming everything on Satan, by the way, but you know, the thief tries to get us to veer off the road. So we walk along, we think, yeah, fantastic, praise God. But then we get to a point, sometimes somewhere down the journey, and then we sort of look back and go, but I like that bit of my life, that was all right. I like that bit of my identity, there's nothing wrong with that, is there? No, no, it's okay, that's okay, I can have that. I want to trust Jesus, but, and Jesus is going, come on, come down the road. And we're going, yeah, just a minute, Jesus. Yeah, I'm going to come in, I'll be right there, but I just want to take this with me. And Jesus saying, no, leave it. You've left it. Forget it. You died to that. That's dead and buried. The power in that's died and buried. Don't forget about that. And you're going, okay, I'll come. No, hang on. I'll be back in a minute. Hang on. Whoa. And you somehow come back. And I talk to myself. We somehow come back and we go, oh, yeah, I like this one. This is all right. I'll have this one. I'll have this back again. And then you go to put it on and fit through the door, but you can't because... Well, it doesn't quite fit comfortably. Do you know why? Because it's no longer you. This is not who Jesus created you to be. Whatever this represents for you, this is not you anymore. I don't care what labels you've been given by people. This is not you. But you can't quite fit it back on the journey because the road is narrow. It doesn't allow the broad worms to spread out. So we go, okay, no worries, Jesus. What I'll do is I'll... That's fine. I can't fit it through, but that's okay. What I'll do is... Oh, yeah, that's great. Fantastic. Hang on a minute. We'll drag it down the narrow road. That'd be great. That'd be cool. Still got it. That's fine. All right. Okay, it's fitted. It's with me. But it doesn't sit on you fully because it's not you anymore. You've been released from it. But somehow we let it attach itself to us. And we are the ones who've put it on because we've been given the power in Jesus to be broken from it. You already died to it on the cross. So you leave it attached and then you walk down the narrow road and after a while you think, hang on, I just want to enjoy this for a while. I'll come back to you later. And you turn and then you fiddle in your bag and you might pull out something. Oh, yeah, that's fun. I'll have some of that. Play with that for a while. Yeah, Jesus, I'll be there in a minute. Yeah, okay, I'm just dealing with my old life for a while. I'm just enjoying this for a minute. Oh, yeah, repent. Yeah, you're right. But you don't let it go. You still have it attached because you want to carry on enjoying some of it. You think that life of joy and abundance is not the true promise that Jesus brings. You think you still need to look back at what's attached to you. So you walk this narrow road with this dragging on you, slowing you down. When Jesus is saying, be released. Be released. Live life. I hope I didn't hear anybody. Be released. Let it go. Let it go. I have come to bring joy and life to its fullness. It is not restrictive. It's about having one vision. It's not about needing choice. It's not about having identity. It's about being released. I know sometimes we look at the Bible and we look at the rules in it that says, you know, certain things you can't do before marriage, and there's certain choices you're not allowed to make, like getting drunk, for instance, or whatever. I'm just naming things off the top of my head, not confessing anything at the front. That sounds restrictive, but it isn't. It's about having joy and abundance. It's about being released from it, because doing all these things is not you. What's you is what Jesus originally made you. He wants us released. He doesn't want you dragging your old self down the path with him. Problem is, you think you have to have it with you, or else you'll lose yourself. But actually, you sever that cord, you will find yourself in Jesus. This is nothing. This is nothing but baggage. This is nothing but baggage. This is not who you are. This just distracts and ties you down. Some of us this morning have had some of our baggage named to us in our own minds by God. Not by me. Some of us this morning know there are things in our life that we need to allow Jesus to cut loose. We got to stop dragging it behind us. Maybe it's bad things that have been said over your life. Maybe it's people have said to you stuff that you know is not true, yet somehow it sits in you like a rotten, painful, open sore. And you feel you have to drag that with you. You don't. Jesus says, you are mine. You're a co-heir with me. God, Father says, you are my child. That counteracts anything else. Maybe it is your identity in your work. You hold so to that you almost become a workaholic. And you think, and if I lose that, I've lost everything. You haven't, because you're still a child of the living God. If you're somebody here this morning who does not know Jesus, and you're sick to death of fighting to find your identity, you keep looking for all the different gates that might be open to find out who you are and to find God, well, Jesus made it quite clear there is one, and he knew what he was talking about because he died for it. And it's here. Maybe you need to enter it now. Maybe through baptism. Maybe for the first time commitment to the Lord. You've had enough of being weighed down with life's worries. If you've got the one vision, there ain't nothing else to worry about. God is here offering this morning for you to make a response to sever the cord of the baggage that is attached to your back, that you are dragging along with you. Sometimes we don't like making physical responses, but actually something spiritual happens as well. No different from baptism. Something physical that's going on, but there's actually more importantly something spiritual that goes on as well. The same thing happens sometimes when we do what we call altar calls. Because sometimes we have to make a public declaration that says, sever this. You don't have to name it. Nobody else needs to know about it. You and God know about it. So would you rather hang on to that, being dragged along, or would you rather lose it? This morning is your opportunity to make that first step forward to severing that cord. I want you to take a few moments just to sit with God for now. Remember what I said about being released and set free? It's painful sometimes. And in a moment, not yet, but in a moment, I'm going to play a song. Now, the strange thing is, I chose at the beginning of the week that we were going to play and listen to Amrita Vani. I had no idea what we were going to be doing different this morning. If this morning you want to make a cord severance of some baggage that sits on you, this morning is the time to come forward to make a response to God. Let's take a few moments, sit with God, and then I'll ask us to stand and we can listen to the music. If you then after that want to make a response, I will do another call. Take some moments, just listen to God. God's already spoken to some of you this morning. Could you please stand? Michael's going to start playing the CD. Liz has just confirmed to me, turn it down a bit, Michael, just a minute. Liz has just confirmed to me what I believe God has been saying for this morning all week. God wants to break stuff in people today. He wants to not break you, break the things that you are tied to. And he wants to do it today. So if you want to run free and unfettered, come forward, sit on the floor, kneel on the floor, stand. And then I and others within the team will just pray for you. We will just pray and pray and pray for God's Spirit to break those things. Now is your opportunity.
Father God, we want to acknowledge that this is your work this morning, that you have spoken so clearly this morning about your heart to see us broken from the areas that have no place in our lives as your sons and daughters. If you still want to have prayer, then please either turn to someone near you or come and speak to one of the people at the front here. But Lord, I pray this morning in Jesus' name that those of us who are responding would have that breaking within that you bring about, because this is your heart for us. You have said, if you want something broken this morning, I am here to break it. Lord, we acknowledge that and we thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Liz is right. If you still want prayer and you've not come forward, come forward. We're still here. With Jesus, there is no running between the narrow and the wide. He wants you fully on the narrow, because there you're released. If you're still sitting on that imaginary fence, understand there's only one gate. You need to enter through it. For all those that did, pray going forward this week, you will recognize that you are running free down that road of life and abundance. God bless to you.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching videos at gbcweb.tv.